Thank you. And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Monastery, the open bar of the internet, the world's greatest shit show, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this most holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, and most batshit ways possible. I am your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra, and with me I have a newcomer to the temple, currently the head of the upcoming, I'd say horror fantasy RPG, Children of the Beast. Nicholas Kitts, how are you doing tonight, man?
It's Friday night, and I am stuffing myself with DoorDash burgers, so... I'm doing all right.
as long as it's not McDonald's, then it's automatically a good burger by default. Not like I'm one to talk, cause I had Devani's a bit ago, but that's because Minnesota.
To keep on going with the burger talk. It was from a local place called Sherry's Cafe and Pies, which is basically Denny's but like leveled up slightly. So.
Okay, so we're both doing local exclusives. I gotcha.
Yep.
Unfortunately, I have to deal with this whole thing of winter ending, which is about as painful as going to a Mariners game.
Well, I'm wrapped in a blanket right now, so
it's around 15 degrees over here.
Okay,
it's starting to get a little more sunny. Although, given the snowstorm over on the coast, I wouldn't be surprised if some of that comes my way, and it'll probably barely graze you by the time it heads that way.
Yeah, I've always been a West Coast boy, so I'm happy I've never had to deal with like snow consistently.
I don't know, the funniest weather event I ever had to deal with was the one time I was in Atlanta and it snowed 1 inch and everybody lost their shit.
Well, yeah, that actually happened here too. Mm-hmm. It snowed a couple inches and Seattle just shut down. But
and I'd be sitting out there in jeans and a t-shirt going, "The hell's wrong with you people? It's 2 inches." But it's a bit of a tradition around here, aside from the drinking, to begin at the beginning. So walk me through your first introduction to tabletop RPGs and what was it that made you stick?
So I originally played first edition Advanced Dungeons and Dragons with my dad, who taught me when I was, like, God, I want to say like 6 years old. And he had this old collection, including what I later found out to be a rare book, in that there was a deities and demigods book that had the Cthulhu mythos in it. Mm-hmm. And apparently the Cthulhu mythos was like removed from later printings of that book because the Lovecraft people got all upset. But yeah, so I grew up playing that with my dad. I played, my first character was a ranger called Sneaker Strider. and I played it with my little brother, and my dad would be the dungeon master, and we would run through things. And first edition AD&D is extremely lethal. And so we were just kind of, I mean, we didn't enjoy that necessarily, but it did make the times we leveled up to like level 3 to be kind of momentous occasions. And once I started running games, I'll be honest, I kind of cheated a lot with my brother, and gave us a bunch of extra stuff and whatnot so that we could fight some of the cooler and weirder things in there. And mm-hmm. I spent a long time going through the various monster manuals and like looking at all the cool black and white artwork and stuff. And that was probably the biggest inspiration for me. I never really stopped playing D&D after that. So I don't know if there was a point where it stuck. It just kind of stuck from the start. Mm-hmm. In like middle school, I was introduced through some friends to 3rd edition Dungeons & Dragons. I never played 2nd edition Advanced Dungeons & Dragons unless you count playing the Baldur's Gate video games, which were a ton of fun, but also really confusing because the rules were close enough to 1st edition that the small differences got added up after a while.
Nice timing bringing up Baldur's Gate, by the way.
Yeah. I'm excited for Baldur's Gate 3. I don't know entirely what to expect out of it because the story pretty much ended. I'm excited. I'm curious to see what they do with it. And even though I haven't gotten the chance and been too busy to play Divinity 2, something like that. I've heard so many incredible things about it, and so I'm really excited to see what they come up with.
Yeah, the when it comes, the only concern that I have is I've seen some people say that the gameplay in there looks a little bit too much like Divinity, which I could certainly see, and it's the reason why I was a bit I was a bit cautious about having the Divinity team working on Baldur's Gate. On one hand, it can seem like a natural fit. On the other hand, old habits die hard.
Yeah, it's also hard in today's modern industry. Once you've created an engine and everything, it's really hard to shift that. You know, especially if you're wanting to adapt it to, like the way Baldur's Gate did things was very strange. So
I ended up getting it when it came to the CRPG thing, which I have to say it's not a boom period, but there's a lot of really really competitive CRPGs and ARPGs on the PC these days. Like it's not a boom, it's not going to be mainstream level, and quite frankly, I want it to stay that way. But you've got a lot of really high quality stuff coming out. You've got Wolfson, which has bugs, but definitely makes up for it with a team that clearly has more passion than they do common sense. there's the giant that is Path of Exile, to the point where they now have their own convention. There's Grim Dawn, which is Diablo 2 with multi-classing. there was Asura Vengeance, which is
depending on how you view Path of Exile, that's kind of it too. But it's freaking skill tree. Anyway,
the skill tree in Path of Exile is not a tree; it is a tumbleweed. And because of how that's set up, I don't even consider that a class-based system.
Yeah, it's its own beast.
Mm-hmm.
I did not. That game requires so many hours of investment.
But I suppose the biggest joke is that Baldur's Gate 3 was announced was initially announced as a quote unquote killer app for the Stadia.
Oh, really? Wow, I did not catch that. That is depressing.
Well, it was announced alongside the Stadia, and with the implication that it was going to be a killer app for it, but since it's going to be on PC and possibly consoles, I think you can guess what people are probably going to be getting it on. All critics have their whipping boys, and the Stadia is definitely mine. Simply because, well, have you seen how the thing has turned out since it launched?
I mean, it's sad.
I feel bad for the people who worked hard on it, but at the same time, we are equal opportunity roasters here in the monastery. So, welcome to hell, Google. We kept the seat warm for you. So most of your experiences were from Dungeons and Dragons. Is that
well? I mean, early experiences. Mm-hmm. Once I started hitting around middle or high school, was when I started getting introduced to other things. I think I think one of the big ones I remember was I played World of Darkness, you know, Vampire the Masquerade, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Just slowly got exposed to a ton of other stuff, especially here in Seattle now. My current life often ends up playing a lot of narrative games, since that's kind of the culture around here, is a lot of narrative games.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been a really interesting world to learn from, just because even though they're not always the types of games that I have a driving urge to play, I tend to be more for longer form stuff, obviously. They're really creative and really innovative with all different ways they try to attempt different styles. I'm just really impressed whenever I meet with designers and talk about their new games or their new ideas. And even if it doesn't really work out, it's where a lot of RPG innovation is happening nowadays.
Which I can understand that. For me, it's kind of, in Minneapolis, it's more of a board gaming and war gaming scene than it is anything else, which isn't too surprising given where I grew up is where Blackmoor got its start and the Napoleonic campaign got its start.
Oh.
Because that was in St. Paul, the better Twin Cities, by the way. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. So that brings us to Children of the Beast, which I think I could, which you had described as Bloodborne meets D&D in the Kickstarter pitch.
Yeah, so we've actually kind of refined that post Kickstarter to be heroes for a hopeless world of grotesquely beautiful organic horror, mm-hmm. Hope that kind of gets across the vibe, I guess, a little better.
I think it does. I do think that and to be fair, you are definitely not the first game designer I've had on to reference Bloodborne.
Yeah.
But at the same time, bringing that up brings in certain connotations, namely the more I don't want to say Lovecraftian, but more cosmic horror and much, much more Victorian British.
Yeah, I was about to say we do have cosmic horror, but we don't have that Victorian era kind of stuff.
I'd say if I'm to use a location, I'd say what we've got here has much more in line with Eastern Europe than it does the British Isles.
Yeah.
And that's simply because a German or a Polish forest is filled with strange, wonderful creatures that want to kill you.
But even still, I doubt most people would know what I'd be meaning if I said an RPG like a Polish forest. But
I don't know. Maybe you could have brought up Darkwood.
Oh, that's interesting.
Anyway,
I funnily enough, I actually got that recommendation for how to pitch it from I was going to a meetup, and I was telling people that I was really struggling with coming up with a succinct way of talking about the game, mm-hmm. and I met a former marketing executive for the Xbox team, and he recommended, you know, he was basically find a way to relate it to something people know and then tell us how it's different. And I don't think that's a terrible way to go about things, but I'm guessing that
this person was not on the marketing team during the Xbox One reveal.
No, I think he was. I think he was on, Xbox 360 era. I'm not entirely sure.
Okay, that makes more sense then.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, I took that advice and was like, hey, you know, I don't know what I'm doing. I'll try to do the best I can with that. Yeah, it's an interesting world, finding out ways to pitch your weird ass game. So,
Now, one of the I looked into in the interest of disclosure, I am one of the backers. But one thing that I could definitely say is, even though it's not going full on at the same tier, there is a bit of Giger-ness to it in that I'd say Giger, but less mechanical. But it definitely is pulpy. One of the things that I couldn't help but notice, and this is something that I've seen a few other games do, but not quite as many as I'd like, is so where'd the idea come from to do the companion app?
Yeah, so actually there's a bit of a story behind that one. So we started this project like about 6 years ago. And the original goal was for it to be an app only game, as in no book, because the pitch was, hey, we've got this app that teaches you the game and runs you through like a sample adventure and stuff and manages a bunch of things for you. Let's get rid of a bunch of barriers to people playing RPGs and kind of have this sort of almost video gamey tabletop hybrid experience that you can just get into super easily. And we ran into a couple problems with that. Main one being, we didn't have a way to make money off of that because people don't like paying money for apps. So if we said, hey, back us on Kickstarter, $50 to buy an app, most people would just not bite. The other thing is, and this was something that it took me a long time to appreciate, surprisingly, even though I've played RPGs for almost my entire life, is that just books are beautiful objects, and having a physical piece of media to interact with and be able to take to future generations is even how I got into this. So, since my dad taught me D&D and everything. We unfortunately started working on the book a little later than I would have liked. And it's caused some unfortunate delays. That was the original goal of the app, was we wanted to make a more streamlined experience. And we wanted to make a more complex experience that was made simpler by the fact that an app was handling a lot of the mechanics. This is somewhat backfired in the sense that now we have, since there's the book and everything, the game is pretty complex, even though I've been trying to manage how exactly how exactly people learn it from the book. There are some mechanics that I've had to like tweak and whatnot just to make it more reasonable to play from a physical pen and paper perspective. For example, the app has this crazy in-depth wound system where you can attack like individual toes of creatures. But to actually lay that out in a book and explain all the mechanics for it and get it all to work, it just kind of doesn't work from a pen and paper perspective. It's like, what was that game, like Phoenix Command, I think?
Oh, God.
Yeah. It definitely starts to feel more like that when you try to run the more advanced wound system by hand, and that's rough. So,
given that Because one of the things that I saw with the pitch was the whole individual body parts. Is that still being implemented?
Yeah, yeah. So basically, we just simplified it a bit and took out some of the more unnecessary rules that were just cool because the app would handle it. For example, there's this whole concept with the advanced system called inheritance, where if you smack a body part, like say someone's shoulder, it will cause the everything connected to that body part to like to suffer similar effects. So like if I disabled your shoulder, I struck it really hard and broke your shoulder, that means everything below the shoulder, the arm, the elbow, the hand, all of that is disabled as well because your shoulder got broke. Instead, in the new in the simpler version used for pen and paper, you just have a series of weak points that when you do enough damage to them, it causes certain effects. Mm-hmm. So rather than having shoulder, arm, elbow, and five fingers, you instead just attack, you know, an arm weak point, which is a lot more simple to manage and effectively does the same thing. It's just, you know, less in depth.
Yeah, I can get that. Now, one of the things that I found interesting looking through the material, even though I had to be reminded that I don't have Photoshop. is the whole thing when it comes to how advancement works?
Yeah.
Now, with the packages that are in there.
Yeah.
It seems that you have one base talent and then two talents that branch off from that one for each package.
Yeah.
And a question that I have is that as far as it goes, or are there going to be further branches in the final book?
So it's a more complicated answer in the sense that so each of those packages you're talking about are called disciplines mm-hmm. in the game. And as you gain various skill points and stuff and level up, you gain more levels. And every level you get, you gain a discipline ability. Now, the thing is, you can... Have you played 3rd edition Dungeons & Dragons?
Yes.
You can almost think of those disciplines more like feat trees. In the sense that you don't take just one, you will get many different disciplines over the course of the game.
Which I can get that, although there's one cardinal difference between feat trees and what you have here.
Yeah.
What you have here makes sense and is organized.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. We try, even though it is complex.
I liked the whole idea of feat trees and feat chains in 3rd edition, but some of the requirements for certain feats back then were excessive.
Yeah. but the thing is that we sort of have an offshoot of disciplines called corrupted mutations, which is when you ingest horrible corruption into your body. Mm-hmm. And that behaves very much like disciplines in that you have a first initial ability. And once you level up again, you've got two choices. But you can advance even further in those. So they have they have higher levels that kind of act like disciplines on top of disciplines.
I'd blow the inception horn if I had it.
Yeah. and with corrupted mutations, we really wanted those, even though you can take multiple, because they can be advanced into so far, we wanted those to be, at least for starting players, the thing you choose what you really want to be. You choose to be a berserker or a commander or whatever, and then advance through that as you become a... Oh, God. We've gone through so many name changes. I believe it's like... Ravager and Exalted. they get name changes as you progress through them, because they're supposed to start out as relatively standard fantasy sounding names of assassin and whatnot. And then as you advance the assassin and you become more mutated, it becomes the Spectre. And then finally, once you mutate even further, it becomes the Reaper, as you start harvesting people's souls and eating them or using them as power-ups for your weapons. So,
which that does bring me to one other thing that I couldn't mm-hmm. help but notice. So, in the general vibe that I get out of Children of the Beast is that the PCs are people who have what is known as hunter's blood, and are able to hunt these massive and really, really damn ugly to the point where even the predator would say, "One ugly motherfucker." and in killing them, they can get the beast's hearts.
Yeah.
Or I can't remember if it was hearts or if it was cores. The point is
it's technically both.
And they can either take these back home and sell them off for cash, or crush them and absorb their power and through that gain corruption.
Yeah.
So when it comes to that, one question that I have is there a kind of base management system in the full book?
What do you mean by base management system? Oh, do you mean like home base?
Yeah, because in the material that I was able to get, what I saw was a lot of talk of using that money to upgrade shops, upgrade the society, and so on.
Yeah. We have a sanctuary rule. That's what we call them. It's not intended to be incredibly in-depth management stuff. We just wanted it to be so that you could invest money into your sanctuary. And as you invest money into it, interesting people come into your town as it grows. And these interesting people can have various, you know, qualities that help improve your town and give you more capabilities. And you can also invest it into your little society of hunters, where, yeah, you were talking about the shops and everything. You upgrade the bone smiths and the flesh smiths so that you can open up higher level equipment and flesh smithing. That's where we focused. There's other types of management in other games that I've seen where it's like, you know, really getting down into the nitty gritty of this is what you tax your society, or this is you do almost a city planning of building a building here or there or whatever. And we don't want to focus on that. At least for now, we just wanted to have it be a relatively simple system of just upgrading your home and getting cool people to come to it. So yeah, we've put some effort into that.
Mm-hmm. Now, one question that I had. Now you admit, now there was the whole tier thing with the corrupt disciplines. Is that the case? Is there a similar case with the normal ones, or is the normal disciplines only that? Actually, no. What? Never mind. That was already addressed. Actually, now when it comes to the equipment, is as far as getting higher level stuff by having better smiths and the like. Is it on a tiered system, or is there an item level approach?
I want to say both. So there are two ways you can advance your weapons. you can, as you hunt creatures and stuff, you get access to their body parts. And their body parts can be used to forge better stuff. And so the higher tier of creature, the higher tier of weapons and armor you can make out of it.
Mm-hmm.
But also, at a base level, as your bonesmith becomes stronger, they'll be able to upgrade the quality of your weapons, which is just kind of a weapon level, as you might say. And both of those things together make the overall strength of your weapon. I guess both, really.
Now, when I looked at how leveling worked, it reminded me of stuff like insight ranking from L5R, where it's not a straight experience approach the way D&D's leveling system is, but more of a general rank based on the stuff that you've invested into improving.
Yeah.
In that regard, is it a similar approach when it comes to, corruption, where you need a certain number of corruption points in order to level up? And if so, what's the formula? Because the formula for skill point leveling, I was able to find easily.
Oh, the formula. God, it's been a long time since I've looked at it. God, we've changed it so much over playtesting. I don't remember if there is a strict formula. I don't think there actually is. It was sort of based off of, this may sound a bit strange, but, I try to do progression in terms of, how often are we expecting people to level up in something per every couple sessions or whatever. And I tried to make that as even as possible. So preferably they level up humanity their first session, they level up corruption their second, they level up humanity again their third, that kind of thing. And then it spreads out more as they get farther and farther along.
Mm-hmm.
And with corruption, it didn't end up being quite as simple as what humanity ended up being, partially because I wanted progressing to the next name of corrupted mutation, going from assassin to specter, to feel like a more momentous occasion than just getting farther into assassin. So I made the level up requirements to getting into the next name a little bit harder, whereas just getting the next little boost a little bit easier relatively. This was also to make sure that you were encouraged to hunt higher tier stuff rather than just hunting low tier stuff over and over again in order to progress to the next name. I mean, you can still do it, but it would just take longer. Mm-hmm. I don't remember if there was an actual strict formula, but I definitely remember that it was staggered in a kind of unusual way, I guess.
All right, I can get that. When it comes to the whole body parts thing, would it be fair to say that that even though the hearts when it comes to the beasts is definitely important, that other body parts can be harvested as well? And I am totally not asking this question because I'm a longtime Monster Hunter fan.
Other body parts can be harvested. It's kind of lumped all together in terms of just materials. However, there's a concept in the game called flesh smithing where you can sort of merge body parts of a creature with yourself. And although there isn't a strict, this creature has four arms and two legs kind of thing, it's It basically says if you've used parts to fuse an arm with yourself and doesn't have any more arms, your judge should say nobody else should be able to fuse arms onto yourself. But it's sort of like whenever you kill a creature, strictly speaking, the two main rewards you get are the heart and the wrist, which are its own two separate piles, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Now, one question that I am a bit curious about is in regard to the equipment, because it definitely has the vibe of potentially having multiple attack types with different weapons. So what I'm curious about is how customizable is given, say, weapons.
So how customizable? I mean, we have a decent number of weapon selection, but in terms of like grafting on new special abilities to weapons and kind of changing its qualities according to what you'd prefer or something like that, we didn't really want to focus on that for this first release, mainly because that stuff gets complicated, and the game is already so complex that we really had to try to choose our battles on what we really wanted people to learn. It's definitely more like with, you know, for example, with armor, you have different armors depending on what you killed, and each of the armors has different abilities, but it's not like you swap out helmets and boots individually, like in say Monster Hunter, in order to see how much you can get out of a particular set. Not yet anyway. And partially a big reason for this is we didn't want the inventory management portion of the game, where people got their stuff and now they're figuring out what to do with it, to be an excessive portion of the game. It's not incredibly customizable like some systems, but it's also just not the deep focus of the game. There's so many other ways to customize your character.
Yep. And now, admittedly, what I was considering when it came to that is if somebody wanted to take the parts from a beast and craft a warhammer out of say the bones.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that'd be doable with the rule set, or would it require a bit of stretching things?
Oh yeah, you can do it. Just the tier of the monster parts you're using is the tier of the weapon that you make. It's just that it mostly affects stats and is not like a more complex system of grafting on spines to a hammer makes it deal piercing damage or something like that. That would have to be your own custom thing.
No, although grafting spines to a hammer gives a very grindy feel to it.
Yeah. This is ultimately a group game, not like a single player video game.
Yeah, but as I said before we went live, I love putting in dumb shit into my stuff. Now, when it comes to the disciplines, one thing that I very much noticed, and this is the reason why I made that joke earlier, taking a shot at feats from D&D 3rd edition, it seems that there's a bit of an economy of motion or economy of actions when it comes to how discipline abilities work, or you've got a mix of passive and active ones.
Yeah.
Was there a was there um
Was the referendum attempt early on to have most of them be passive, but it was decided otherwise, or was this always the approach that was intended?
Oh man, God, I have to think back years now because, how did we first do it? I definitely, I believe originally had it so that a lot of them were active, but they didn't have a limited number of uses. It was instead just some new aspect of your character that they kind of gained as a new type of action that they can use forever. And funnily enough, that ended up being less enjoyable than limiting the uses of them, which we weren't expecting in playtesting. We were going like, hey, more player freedom. Surely that's the best. But in actuality, what it did was, you enjoy having your new ability, but actually the act of playing that character would always be the same. You would do your thing. When you're in a combat, you built your character to do the specific thing and it's going to do it. And so one of the strengths, paradoxically, of limiting the amount of use is that it makes using them more exciting because it's the choice to actually use this limited resource that you have that gives you an edge. So we didn't try to make them all passives, but that was an interesting learning experience for us as we were testing things out in the early stages.
Yep. Now correct me if I'm wrong with this.
Mm-hmm.
So Children of the Beast is D20 based.
Yeah, sort of.
Okay, since you brought up the sort of, would you care to expand on that?
Yeah. So, basically, the idea is you get more D20 dice the more skill you have in a skill, and when you roll them all, you end up taking the highest. It's kind of like, for any of you all who've played 5th edition, it's kind of like a tweaked advantage system, but where you're almost always assumed to have advantage.
it's an advantage system that makes sense.
Yeah. you've got, like, most things, even if you're kind of crap at it, you'll probably have 2 dice with it. And the idea is that, you know, this is a game about playing heroes, even though it is a horror aesthetic and everything. It's about overcoming horrors. And so one of my pet peeves with a lot of RPG systems is the rate of failure. And so I wanted it to be that the more skilled you are at something, the more consistent you are at something. Your stats or whatever provide you bonuses that like increase your potential. Like now I can roll 25s or 30s or whatever. But if you're highly skilled in something, it means that if you're trying to climb a ladder and you roll a climb check, the expert isn't still going to fail 25% of the time. That always cheesed me off in ways that I really didn't appreciate. And so that's what we were trying to do with it. It's not like, I've seen a lot of games nowadays that try to do things with dice that bring more of a narrative, out of the dice. But that isn't our focus. Our focus is just simply having a system where when you're an expert, you can be relied on for that thing.
All right. So, In this regard, would it be fair of me to say that when it comes to a given roll, you're rolling a number of d20s equal to the skill and taking the highest result and then modifying that with the attribute, or where does
you got it.
All right, which given that I'm guessing that the that the default difficulty to pass stays fairly consistent?
I mean, it depends, especially because, you know, if you're not so good at whatever the task is, you're probably not going to do that great. The funny part is that it allows us to have higher target numbers and feel confident in giving those higher target numbers. If that, like 25 is a target number that most novice characters just won't be able to roll. Just practically impossible. But for a higher level character who's invested into that thing, their chance to succeed is likely going to be around the golden statistic that we try to go for. Is things start to feel reliable if you succeed roughly 2/3 of the time, about 70%. So that was the goal, to make it so that with the higher target numbers and the higher difficulty challenges you face, you will be succeeding them about 70% of the time if you're trained in it.
All right, I can definitely get that, especially since a lot of cases seem to fixate a bit too much on 50-50, let's say.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of that. I want to feel like if I'm good at something that I should be able to rely upon. Well, okay, so I know I'm saying this whole, like, you know, relying upon stuff thing, but I actually think it helps out a lot of creativity, because I personally, especially in modern D&D, don't really see people using skills that often. I don't see people using creative ideas that often. I see people mostly sticking to the abilities or spells that the character has and doing whatever. And coming from first edition Advanced Dungeons and Dragons, and to an extent, sometimes more of an OSR mindset, I like people coming up with creative solutions to interesting obstacles is like the name of my game. Mm-hmm. And the only way you can do that and have plans that you're confident in is if you can rely on mechanics to go in your favor. And so that's why I care so much about high chances of success and stuff you're good in, because I think it actually encourages more creative play.
A fallacy that I've seen with the whole chances of success is that high chances make the game too easy, which I obviously I find that to be rubbish. But
yeah,
and it's something I see a lot in OSR. Mm-hmm. Me personally. I there's a certain elephant in the room that I feel apropos in addressing, and that's the fact that D&D was never designed to have a skill system.
No.
not in the same way other RPGs are.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, when they tried to implement one in they tried to implement it with the whole proficiency thing with AD&D 2nd, which felt undercooked, and then yeah, with the skill system in D&D 3rd, which was definitely undercooked. you kind of have that problem, especially since with a lot of people during third edition, They could barely get any points for their skills.
Yeah.
Unless you, it fed into the whole problem of Have you ever heard of a term known as multiple ability dependency?
Oh, definitely sounds familiar, but no, care to educate me?
if you think about most classes, you can typically get by having a high score and maybe two ability scores.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Multiple ability dependency is when a class requires more than two in order to be competent. The poster boy for this was the monk. Because he needed at least three high ability scores to actually survive.
Yeah.
But when it comes to now, obviously with Children of the Beast, I think this nestles itself very firmly in being a game with the skill system built around it.
Yeah. Yeah.
One question, and I can definitely see some of the third edition influence just by looking at how you designed the character sheet.
Fair enough.
It's nothing overt. It's just little hints with some of the box formatting. Mm-hmm. And when you've looked at as many character sheets as I have, you tend to notice patterns.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I didn't design the character sheets, so I'll take that. I'll take that however I will.
Yeah, but you still had to approve of it in some form.
Oh yeah, for sure.
And one thing that I'm kind of curious about is how it seems that health was handled when it came to combat, because when I look at the second page of the character sheet, what I see is that we do not have the static affair when it comes to how it works. So one thing that I'm curious about is the relationship between willpower, blood, and breakdown.
Yeah. So way back when we were first designing stuff, we decided that we wanted, you know, having a character approach death should like mean something. And that's sort of what created this willpower and blood system, where essentially they're both health, they're both, you know, numbers that go down. But willpower goes down first, and once willpower is gone, you gain a breakdown bonus, where your character at character creation got to choose a special bonus that they get when they're close to death, as their like adrenaline kicks in and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And they are more as they try to desperately defend themselves as they approach their own demise. And this also happens with creatures that you face. So as you whittle down a creature, they get stronger in their final moments too. We wanted this to add sort of a sense of pacing to the game. And also because I think it's a neat twist on what I usually see with this kind of mechanic. I hate to be referencing D&D so much. It's just an easy reference point, even though I've played a bunch of other RPGs. Mm-hmm. But 4th edition has a concept called Bloodied.
Yeah, that's what I was going to bring up. And kudos for bringing up 4th, a.k.a. the game that everybody hates but me.
it's incredibly well-designed for what it was. Just too bad it wasn't what a lot of people wanted. I'm not going to lie, though. I have studied 4th edition. It is a work of mathematical art, let me tell you. I'm a statistics nut, so forgive me if
I work in logistics. I have no room to talk.
So normally with stuff like Bloodied, I actually don't remember how I didn't play much this, so it might have been a similar kind of thing, but that was, you know, if someone reaches half health, something happens once they reach half health.
On its own, all that happens is you're considered bloodied, but certain monsters and certain abilities can take advantage of that, is how it is meant to be.
Yeah, so in other games, I've seen it kind of be a death spiral thing, where getting close to death means you get certain penalties. Mm-hmm. And I really don't like that side of things, unless you're playing, like, Call of Cthulhu or something, where you're just kind of expected to die eventually. I just don't like the experience of a death spiral. I don't think... I think it just leads to combat slowing down, if anything.
It can lead to people playing defensively.
And like, that. Oh, my God. We wanted to do something special with it. And we also wanted to just be a part of your character, like kind of inform a little bit about their personality by choosing how they react to death, which is, I think, an interesting choice. Mm-hmm.
I can definitely see that. Given that, one thing I'm curious about was the three tier that we have. So charisma plus 2 plus 4 plus 6.
Mm-hmm.
Is that rooted in how many total pips they have in charisma?
Yeah, so it's how high their bonus is. So if their bonus has reached plus 2 or plus 4 or plus 6, their breakdown bonus actually gets stronger because their force of personality manifests itself in those desperate times. And so that's one of the main uses for charisma, which we thought was pretty neat, was like you become a serious badass once you are threatened, I guess.
Hey, if it can work for anime, I don't see why it can't work here.
Yeah.
Plus, there's cases like Tekken where, in the last couple of Tekkens, where once your health reached a certain threshold, you could actually do a little bit more damage to try and make some kind of reversal.
Yeah.
So, there's a precedent for this kind of thing, and plus, Final Fantasy has had the whole limit break thing for years.
Yeah, yeah.
So, it's one of those things where. Where I think you're in good company.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when it comes to the creatures, one thing that I'm curious about, especially with how the whole thing works. Describe to me how damaging the different body parts is intended to work in game.
Okay, so, in the pen and paper version of the game, you can just attack a creature and just try to deplete its health, or you can aim for a weak point. And there's like a list of weak points for each creature, and it's something that should be fairly obvious. I'd rather it be that people know what all the weak points are of a creature, or you know, the judge running the game like just hints at it heavily. But depending on how small or difficult to hit that particular weak point is. You have an aim penalty, which is you take away some of your many 20-sided dice and kind of reserve them off to the side. And you roll what dice you have left, and if that hits, then you hit the weak point. And if you do enough damage, there's sort of a chart of effects, or thresholds, rather, where you do enough damage and you might weaken it. disable it or even remove it. And also, each weak point can have its own specific special effect. So if you stab someone in the eye, they can get blinded, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
One thing we really tried to do with that is we wanted big impactful moments when you attack weak points. So in a traditional weak point system or hit location system that I've seen, it's along the lines of, you know, when you lose both of your legs, you can't move anymore kind of thing. And, you know, that's cool, but it's really hard to remove two legs. It's really hard to remove two legs and then, like, have the person still be alive for you to really capitalize on that. We instead made it so if you hit an arm and, like, stun it or something like that, mm-hmm. you've got this giant claw that's been clawing people up real bad, and you stun that arm, maybe I should use legs as an example. You stun a leg, it makes the whole creature immobile for the rest of the round. It's only for the round, but you get this big effect out of it just by hitting that one leg, and you don't have to, like, tear the entire leg off either. You just have to do enough damage so that it's just taken off guard for a brief moment. Same with stabbing in the eyes. If it has 20 or 30 eyes, you only need to stab one for it to flinch and be blinded for a round. You can just have this effect be permanent if you manage to remove all of the body parts that provide that effect. So if you manage to chop off all the legs, it'll never move again. Mm-hmm. But stabbing it once will still make it immobile for a time.
Yeah. Now, in looking at some of the sheets when it comes to creatures,
mm-hmm.
and the fact that now I can see the whole tier system that you have in mind.
Mm-hmm.
I'm curious about the AI thing that I'm seeing.
Yeah. What do you want to ask about it? Like, just what it is, or
yeah, mainly what it is and how it's implemented in play.
So the idea is that if you get into a fight with this type of creature, the AI can be used as, like, a default set of commands that you go through, like a robot. Mm-hmm. And so you go from, it'll say, like, this is what it does. creatures can have multiple turns called phases in a round. And so it'll say, like, on this phase, it'll go through this list of actions. So you go from the top to the bottom. And sometimes it says, like, it'll move if, you know, someone isn't next to it. But if it is someone next to it, just move to the next one. So you go to the next one and it's like, bite the crap out of them. Mm-hmm. And so it'll try to bite the crap out of them if it can. And it'll keep going through each of these actions until either the end of the list or it has run out of its actions for the turn, just as any other, like, living creature in the game can. So it's to provide, like, a base experience for people for what to expect. It's not required. A good GM of any game can run a creature effectively and interestingly. Especially with how deadly the game can be, especially if you don't know what you're doing, I really wanted to provide the tools for the person running the game so that they can more confidently be able to do this stuff. Because, once again, game is complicated, so I wanted to provide as many things as I can to experience for everybody.
Now, I remember looking into it and showing some of my associates the mechanics, and I kept seeing a lot of people making comparisons to certain works, although.
Mm-hmm.
Bloodborne was not one that got brought up often. One that I did see get brought up a few times was the manga Claymore.
Oh, I haven't read that. I've had it recommended a couple times though.
Yeah, that's one that I'd see get brought up infrequently when just showing people the page. So one thing that I'm curious about is we've talked about what mediums would you say put the idea of what would become Children of the Beast in your head?
Well, this is a very personal project. It's an expression of a lot of things, so for example, one of my favorite games is Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask.
Man of Culture.
I like adventures. I like going on adventures and experiencing stories. I'm drawn to RPGs. What can I say? But I've played tons of different genres. But also I really like dark spins on things that have very philosophical undertones to them. Warhammer 40K is something that I find immensely interesting, but also the shallowest pool in terms of emotional depth, you know? Some incredible designs out of that, but it's not, there is only war, and boy, are we gonna beat the shit out of each other. So I like games about people going on journeys and affecting things, talking to people and discovering horrible truths. It's really just kind of what I like. It's funny about essentially being told that Bloodborne isn't a great reference, because I wasn't sure either. It was just a good reference point for a lot of the things that I enjoy, because even though aesthetically Bloodborne is very different, the experience of that game is going through this strange world and slowly finding out that there are horrible eldritch beings and you're not fighting just werewolves. And that core feel of going through it is core to what I'm trying to accomplish here.
Yeah, I can see that, and I didn't want to imply the wrong idea when I made that crack about Bloodborne.
Oh, I don't feel insulted or anything, so don't worry about that.
It was more of the fact that there are certain assumptions that people make whenever that name is brought up.
No, it's true.
Plus there's the fact that I'm sure you're sick of it's the Dark Souls of blank meme as much as I am.
Yeah. I mean, oh my god. We were very close to calling it Dark Souls meets Monster Hunter. And I'm really glad we didn't.
So am I, because once upon a time there was a Twitter account page who all that they did was collect articles and how that referenced Dark Souls even when they weren't talking about a Souls game.
That's great.
I'm not sure if that account is still up, but I treat that with about as much hilarity as the account that is counting down how many days it's been since the Flyers last won a Stanley Cup.
Oh my god.
So it's effectively counting down every single day since April 1975.
Oh god.
And it is a thing to behold. But when it one thing that I'm definitely curious about, This is definitely a game that is very clearly rooted in its style.
Mm-hmm.
And when it comes to going into the wilderness where the beasts are,
mm-hmm.
has there ever been the consideration of setting up a module to be run like a hex crawl?
Ah, yeah. That was one consideration. We didn't end up doing it, mainly because with the particular people we had and the types of talent that we had, we didn't think we could pull it off, like in a way that would make us satisfied. There are plenty of subpar RPG products out there, but I want to try to not be one of them. So, that was very helpful. Because a big part of the game is about exploration, and so hex crawl is kind of the go-to for a lot of people when it comes to the idea of exploration.
Mm-hmm.
That being said, I do find that they have a couple weaknesses, unless your GM is just crazy and like fills every hex with an idea, which happens, and I salute those people. For me, I have a really rough history with perfectionism, and that would take me so long that I don't know what I'd do with myself. but hex crawls are cool.
Yep. I think the other question I had is, Can I assume that you've got some kind of encounter tables set up or that are in consideration?
Yeah. So we didn't really put this, not actually technically book yet, but each of the locations we list in the game, like the Barrowmire, the Glass Forest, all. It's intended to come with a description of the general area, the kinds of people and things you can find and kinds of troubles that are there, and for a page of random encounters for you to be able to roll up when exploring through there.
Okay. I think that's definitely going to help, because a lot, in my experience, some people need to be, for lack of a better word, weaned off of D&D assumptions.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll be honest, as I have lost a lot of my passion for it, that system specifically.
I'm not sure if I ever lost my passion for it. I feel like it just shifted.
Yeah, maybe that's a better word.
Because it, and maybe you've had a similar experience, but for me, it shifted towards appreciating the people who don't work for Wizards of the Coast and what they can do with it.
Yeah. Yeah. I have a lot of friends at Wizards of the Coast, so I should not comment further on that.
I'm not gonna go too harsh into that, because I already have. Well, it is what it is. Well, welcome to the monastery where everybody gets roasted.
I mean, like, yeah. I mean, it's just the effect of living 20 miles. I mean, 20 minutes away from their offices. You know.
Yeah, I can certainly get that. And meanwhile, what are they going to do? Drive all the way to Minnesota?
Yeah.
Which, first off, if they do that this time of year, they're going to get a fresh blast of cold air, and Minnesota winter is an acquired taste.
Fair enough.
As in, you either acquire the taste to deal with it, or you move down to Florida.
I'd nope. probably be a Florida man if those nope. were my only choices.
No, no, you wouldn't. You do not want to be a Florida man. believe me. Every week somebody sends me a new Florida man story. and some of them are a case of Whiskey Tango Foxtrot. But the another thing that I'm curious about is, now it definitely seems that there's an implication that if your corruption level is too high, then you effectively become lost. Is that a case where it would mainly happen if your corruption level was higher than your humanity level, or are there other means?
That's the only mechanical way it can happen. I mean, God, that's always the tricky part of things, is finding ways to say, you know, but do what you want, man. But so yeah, that's the main way. One reason we like it is just simply because we have a mechanic called wild corruption levels, which are essentially purely negative. They just increase your corruption number without giving you any benefits. And so we prefer the way for people to get closer to becoming abominations, which is the thing you're talking about, by having horrible effects increase their corruption level without giving them special powers. There's the whole concept of death in the game where you're kind of flung into this dreamscape and fucked with. And that experience can often increase corruption and similar other things when exposed to virulent sources of it. The main reason we like doing it that way, rather than saying this can cause you to become an abomination, is because it provides a warning. People know that they're getting close. So they can sometimes be a bit more careful with what things they try to do.
All right, that makes sense. Now, if as a kind of capstone, if you could give one one defining statement to the question, what is Children of the Beast? What would that be?
Well, I feel like it would be kind of that pitch statement I gave earlier, being heroes for a hopeless world of grotesquely beautiful organic horror. Monster hunting is definitely a part of it. Arguably, it doesn't have to be, depending on how you go about it, but monsters are very much a part of the world. If you enjoy that aesthetic and you enjoy that feel while still feeling heroic, you'll probably enjoy the game.
All right. With that said, I do want to sincerely thank you for taking the time out of your busy schedule, as well as the weather issues, to come down to the temple. And if the stars are right, I'd love to have you back on in the future.
Yeah. Oh, thanks. This was enjoyable.
Mm-hmm. And as for everyone else, thank you all so very much for taking the time to enjoy the shenanigans at play here. The next iteration of Gaming Monk Review will be up at 3 p.m. Central tomorrow. I'm going to be doing a fair bit of crunch in the next 12 hours. But until then, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, my name is Mildra. I am your gaming monk. Stay fucking frosty, everybody.